now to the ethical implications the redefining of gender can have on society. To offer her expert opinion on the matter, we invited Mary Rice Hassan, a fellow at the Ethics and Public Policy Institute, to join us. Mary directs a program that focuses on gender ideology called the Person and Identity Project. Mary, thank you so much for being with us. To kick us off, give us some framework. You've talked and we've heard a lot about gender ideology. What is gender ideology?
Gender ideology is a set of beliefs about the person and about what a human being is. And one of the important things to know that both Pope Francis and the Vatican document from the Congregation on Catholic Education have emphasized is that what is proposed by gender ideology, the understanding of the person, is in direct conflict with Christian anthropology. Because instead of seeing the person as created by God, lovingly created as male or female, it's the person is presumed under gender ideology to be able to define themselves. So your identity becomes the choice of the individual, is the way the Vatican document phrased it. And that's not, it's neither reality, because you can't change sex, but it's also just not true in a deeper sense. We're created beings, and we need to acknowledge that. There's a design to our bodies. We have a human nature. And gender ideology sweeps all of that aside and says that it all comes down to our feelings, our self-perception, or gender identity, as they call it, regardless of our body, and that we're free to self-create, to define ourselves.
So you mentioned church teaching on this, and most medical associations as well define sex as binary. And from a Catholic perspective, our Bible teaches us God made us both male and female, as you mentioned. There's this push now to redefine sex, and some who say that sex is assigned by doctors at birth. How does that conflict then directly with church teaching?
Well, first, it conflicts with basic biology, because sex refers to the organism's organization towards a reproductive role. And reproduction occurs when sperm meets egg. Those are the only two components. There are only two sexes across biology. And so for the human being, you are created male or female, and that doesn't change. It's reflected on the cellular level. It's reflected in your entire body's organization, whole body, whole person. It's not just sort of parts, which is sometimes the way it's spoken of in the media or among people who are promoting the idea of transgender identities, as if you swap out certain body parts and that changes who you are. So that's just not true. And the church also points out that we're created as a unity of body and soul. It's impossible to conceive of being me without understanding that who I am is an embodied person. We don't separate the two. But gender ideology proposes something different. It says a person's self-perception, their gender identity, as it's called, can override the reality of biological sex. And further, it goes on to say that society should be affirming and validating of those identities, those self-perceptions, and grant access and rights on the basis of those of that self-perception. Again, regardless of the truth about the person, the reality that you can't change sex, and the reality that men and women are different, and women in particular, sex discrimination laws came about to give women opportunity while at the same time recognizing the importance of sexual difference and protecting our privacy, protecting our safety. And that's been permitted under the law. But now with these changes to insert gender identity in the law and to redefine sex to include gender identity, it really just steamrolls right over females' rights, but also just obliterates our common understanding of the human person as a unity of body and soul. Sex doesn't change. Our feelings, our self-perception cannot override that. So we're all kind of being forced in some ways to live in a world that is spinning this narrative that is simply not true. It's not grounded in reality.
And Mary, you're also a lawyer and you've testified before Congress on this issue. Let's lean into the legal implications that you were mentioning. Last year, the Supreme Court redefined sex in Title VII for employment protections. How does that redefinition of sex impact society more broadly?
Well, the Supreme Court was very careful. In the Bostock decision is what you're referring to. It was a Title VII employment case. And it specifically said sex discrimination, discrimination on the basis of sex, includes discrimination on the basis of sexual orientation or gender identity. But it presumed in that opinion that sex was referred to biological sex, the difference between male and female. But in the ensuing year, what we've seen with the change of administration is a full court press to expand, to extrapolate from the Bostock decision, and to say that even though that decision recognized that there are religious liberty implications, there are privacy implications, there are all sorts of other areas of the law that are touched by this idea of sex and sexual difference and discrimination law. And the administration instead has sort of swept that aside and proclaiming that they're simply applying Bostock. They have said, no, sex means gender identity. And that's how we're going to interpret it across the federal government, Title IX, things like that. And really, people need to understand that when you say gender identity, that definition means self-perception, your feelings, regardless of sex. So it specifically overrides the idea that the law previously recognized sexual difference and the need to ensure equality while protecting privacy and safety. And so under the Equality Act, under many of the changes proposed by this administration, all of that is put at risk, and including the whole issue of religious liberty. But even just looking at the implications of redefining sex in a way that is just detached from reality is tremendously problematic. And, you know, I'll throw something else in here that I've seen in looking at the educational materials that are put out by the public schools.
Right.
Many of them are changing their descriptions of biology to no longer talk about, for example, in health education, female puberty and male puberty. They just talk about bodies with certain parts. So it's just erasing the truth about who we are, all in service to this ideology.
That's right. Well, Mary, you've given us a lot of food for thought, and we'd love to have you come back and talk about the impact of this on children in schools. Thank you so much for being with us today.
Thanks.